Peter Goddard, Director of the Institute for Advanced Study, and it's my pleasant task to welcome you to the Institute and to this conference to mark the 61st birthday of Pierre Deligne. Deligne's influence on mathematics has been wide, deep, and revolutionary, and it's hard to imagine what mathematics would be like today without the impact of his ideas. He has made fundamental contributions to an amazing range of fields of mathematics. Algebraic geometry, for example, his proof of the Hard-Lefschetz theorem, his introduction of mixed Hodge theory, his pioneering use of topological methods to study algebraic varieties in characteristic P, number theory, his proof of the Weyl conjectures, automorphic forms, his foundations for the study of Shimura varieties, representation theory, the Deligne-Lustig construction of representations of the Shefali groups, and the Deligne-Langlands conjectures. Topology, for example, the Baylinson-Bernstein-Deligne-Gaber construction of perverse sheaves. In addition to the great volume of work that bears his own name, he has made many contributions through the assistance and stimulation he has provided to others, giving both his time and his ideas with extraordinary generosity. Many important papers have their genesis in a conversation with Deligne or a letter from him. And he responds with attentiveness and patience to questions from colleagues, no matter how junior or how senior. But on the other hand, his customary meek questioning, "I don't understand," often draws attention to what might at first seem a small lacuna, but often, after hard thought, reveals a fundamental gap that requires serious work to bridge. Beyond his own work and that he has inspired, Deligne has added to mathematical culture through his beautiful expositions of the work of others, whether in lecture series, Bourbaki seminars, or in formal handwritten notes whose repeated copying through many generations tests the resolution of modern Xerox machines, as well as his epic organization of the Institute's quantum field theory notes. Pierre Deligne was born in Brussels 61 years and 2 weeks ago. His serious apprenticeship in mathematics began 14 years later, when a high school teacher and friend of his father lent him parts of Bourbaki. His father wanted him to pursue a career as an engineer that would provide him with a good living, but Pierre realized early on that it was very important for him to be engaged in something that he loved doing, and what he loved doing most was mathematics. When he went to the University of Brussels, his aim was to become a high school teacher and to pursue mathematics as a hobby, for his own personal satisfaction and fulfillment. Studying there under Jacques Tietz, he discovered to his delight that one could actually earn one's living by playing, because his favorite playtime was doing research in mathematics. Tietz encouraged him to go to study in Paris, where he attended seminars by two of the great influences on his own work, Serre and especially Grothendieck. Deligne obtained his doctorate, or rather his first doctorate, from Brussels in 1968. And after a postdoctoral year there, he joined the IHES in Bures-sur-Yvette. After 2 years there, he became a permanent member, and he held this position until he joined the faculty here at the Institute for Advanced Study in 1988. He is widely recognized, of course, with a catalog of prizes and honors from his 1978 Fields Medal onwards. But all of you know this, and you won't want me to recite a catalogue. Pierre's love of mathematics and the playful way he approaches it are reflected in all aspects of his professional and personal life. I don't think he's trying to get surreptitious entry into Princeton University by this garb, but it's at one with his love of nature, walking in the Institute woods. From his wife's house at the edge of the woods, backpacking across Corsica and growing their own vegetables. And his playfulness is everywhere evident, from putting on puppet shows for children, constructing igloos, for which Princeton conveniently provides good conditions at least once a year, and so on. When the Institute puts on parties for children, one can be confident that at least one guest will thoroughly enjoy himself. Pierre Deligne is a much loved and widely respected member of the Institute community and the international mathematical community, admired for his great achievements, for his originality in all matters, for his integrity, and not least for his playfulness and joy in life, a life in which mathematics is an essential and integral part. And now I'm delighted to declare this conference open so we can all get down to play.
Informative introduction to this conference, which and I'm pleased to see you all here to celebrate the 61st anniversary of Pierre Deligne. As the director mentioned, we're 2 weeks too late, but that's all right. Fortunately, we're not 100 years too late, as we might have been if we were more aware of the revolutionary calendar. Now, I think we can thank the organizers of the conference for the excellent collection of speakers that they've assembled. We can thank the speakers who have come, many of them, a long way. And I hope that you'll express this thankfulness by paying close attention to their lectures, thinking over what they're saying, and perhaps asking questions at the end. We want, after all, the speakers will certainly make a good impression on us, but we would like also to make a good impression on the speakers and to show our thankfulness. And apart from that, I think they're so well known that there's no need for me to provide any particular introduction today. So I just will introduce them by giving you their name and reminding you of the title of their talk. The first speaker is Gerd Faltings from Bonn, and he will speak on devices on moduli spaces, I think, for bundles.
So it's sort of unusual that the opening address takes less time than allotted. And I should say it's a great honor for me to be allowed to give the second mathematical talk in this conference. And so I remember I met, well, I think maybe I have to tell this at the dinner, but I met when I came here 85 to the other institution in town, which had a sometimes violent competition with this one. I remember Pierre was here. I didn't know that he didn't have tenure yet, but okay, he seemed to be fine anyway. So I will talk, I essentially talked about the same subject in Paris in June, and I will be able to progress some progress over the summer. I've seen some people already announce their progress there. So I hope to do this too. Okay, so I will speak on vector bundles on curves, which is an old topic. So C is a, now I have to, what's the best way, which board should one start? Which? The middle one? What can you do? You can move them like this, or?
There's a pole on this side, in the corner.
On the corners? Okay, we have a... have to be strong. So, I think I remember in Bonn I was told that you should start with the middle one, so. So C is a smooth projective curve. Geometrically connected, to be sure. And I consider vector bundles, so E, so vector bundles. I think one has to make a see. And they are sort of, in some sense, should be classified by a moduli space or stacks, so classified by. Maybe MG. Well, this would be for the group GLN, but in usual I will consider a semi-simple group. So G, so that E. Trivial, maybe rank E. S A, then the group G is. Well, and I mean, there are sort of several schools of doing this. Well, so a priori, the space of vector bundle is a stack, which sort of, it's not a nice algebraic variety for two reasons. So one reason is that the objects have automorphisms. So objects have automorphisms. For example, if you take bundles with trivial determinant, you always have the scalar automorphism, which gives you the Rth roots of unity. And the other thing is, the thing is not of finite type, so not of finite, maybe not quasi-compact. Because you can have instable bundles, for example, for vector bundles, you could have sums like a line bundle plus its inverse, and the degree could go to infinity, so it's not of finite type. Okay, but I mean, we know how to deal with such things. So, there are several schools. So I used to say that there are two schools. So in Paris, I said there are two schools, the Indian and the Russian school. But then I gave the talk last week in New York, and I was told that there's also the French school. So I will try to tell you what's the difference between them. So the Indian school, so one thing is, the Indian school works sort of with a coarse moduli space of semi-stable bundles. So there, so we can take the coarse moduli space of semi-stable bundles. Well, sort of the advantage is that it's a really projective scheme. So, you can do conventional geometry. But the other problem is that it sort of has only a weak connection to bundles, because it somehow parametrizes bundles, but there is no universal family over it or whatever. And usually, if you study a moduli space, you don't study it because it's embedded into projective space by certain equations, but you study it because it parametrizes some interesting objects, and you want to keep this connection. So that's the drawback of this approach. And the other approach is sort of the Russian approach, is to use loop groups. So this is the following. If you remove one point from the curve, so if you take the affine curve, maybe infinity, then it's known that bundles are trivial on this one. For example, if you look at vector bundles with trivial determinant, then this is given by it's a spectrum of a Dedekind ring. And for a Dedekind domain, you know that projective modules are classified by their determinant. And because the determinant is supposed to be trivial, this means that any such vector bundle with trivial determinant will be trivial on this open. And this also holds for other Gs, so E restricted to C0 will be trivial. And on the other hand, it will be trivial in a small neighborhood of infinity, or, in the Grothendieck sense, in the formal completion, also on C hat, which is the formal completion. At infinity. And then, and then the bundle is determined how you glue those two trivializations. And if t is a local parameter, so little t is a local parameter at infinity, then you see that this moduli stack or space, while the gluing is given by an element in G of the, maybe the ground field of the Lorentz series. I mean, it's like you have a punctured disk and you have a meromorphic section in there. And then you sort of have to divide by the change of trivializations at those two. And this gives you a double quotient. You sort of get g of k of t. And the other side you get maybe g of c0. The elements of g over the open. And all these are just the k-points, but sort of this can be done functorially. So it's a sense of, well, it has some algebraic meaning. Well, this is an algebraic group, but not of finite type. This is an int algebraic group, and this is an int group, but int group scheme. And, well, I mean, int objects have been defined by Grothendieck, so I don't have to talk about them. But sort of you can give this an algebraic description. And now I can, so this is for the Russian and the French school. And the difference between the schools is if you're in the French school, you first take this quotient and then divide by this group. While if you're in the Russian school, you first take this quotient and then divide by that group. So this is, I have all explained, and I follow the Russian school. So I write this as g of c0. Quotient under something called the affine Grassmannian. And so this is the description in terms of stack. Okay, so now what do we want to know about these? So I want to talk about line bundles from NG. So I want to determine peak of NG. Well, and I always do this in the sense of stacks, which means if I have a family of vector bundles over some base, then I want a line bundle on the base, and it should be functorial in every respect. Well, and so then this, by this description, it's the same as a G0 at these invariant vector bundles on DG. So this is, these are GC0 equivariant. Okay, so now, I guess I have to do this one. This is, there's no choice. So this is. Okay, I will refrain from comments about the technology and gaps, transatlantic gaps, and so on. So first of all, one can look at the Picker group of DG itself. And it turns out that this is cyclic. Well, I mean, I assume that G is simple. And so there's, yeah. And then, well, once I know all the Picker groups, then is a question which of those are equivariant. And the first thing one knows is that this has no homomorphism. So G of C0, Gm is trivial. Oh, because I should also say that all the global functions are constants. And because it's trivial, this means that if I have a given line bundle here, it can be equivariant in at most one way. So this means that this contains a peak of this MG. And so one can take a generator and ask whether it's equivariant. And the last time I stayed at the institute, not in Princeton, but I mean in Princeton I was afterwards, but the last time I stayed at the institute, I gave a talk where I explained that you sort of can make the generator equivariant. And so last time IHES at, so it is possible, I mean, equality. Okay, so this Pierre was in the audience, so I don't have to explain this here. So we can make all those line bundles equivariant, so they give us line bundles on the moduli space. So now that we have the line bundles, I look at global sections. And I first do the classical case of theta functions, namely for the group SLR. So, for example, maybe I start with the line bundle. If I have the group SLR, then how do I get, how do I get line bundles or vector bundles on MG? Well, sort of to get vector bundles, there is a silly, trivial way, namely if I have a point. So maybe I mention them here on MG. Well, for example, you can take E as a G representation, and then you get a vector bundle E, maybe. Just to get the associated bundle and take the fiber at x. So fiber at x. Oh, I should. And see. But this doesn't give you interesting line bundles because, let's say, if I have vector bundles with trivial determinants, then if I take the determinant, this is trivial. And the other way, I can look at the cohomology of the vector bundle. Well, these sort of depend in a non-trivial way on the vector bundle. But the problem is that this is not a nice vector bundle on the moduli space because the dimension may jump. But what is continuous is sort of the determinant of cohomology. So I get lambda. Maybe I usually write this. So I take the determinant of H0, CE, determinant. Well, so this is a, for each point, this gives me a line. And I can sort of, in a more general way, if I look at, think about EGA3, so if more generally, if I have a, well, I have a vector bundle on a parametrized by a space S, then I can look at the derived direct image, let's say. And this can be locally represented by a complex of length 2, so locally represented, maybe F0. Well, this is cohomological notation, and I have to follow this. Well, I mean, sort of it extends by 0, which I don't write. And then I can take the det F0 over det F1. And one can check that this is independent of choices, and so gives me this determinant line bundle. I should say, sometimes I can get global sections out of this, namely if the Euler characteristic is 0, so if the rank of F0, F1, well, then not only do I have these individual elements, I also have the map here. And I can take the determinant of this map, so this differential. So then determinant D, which is in this, well, this is an element in the determinant of F1 divided by the determinant of F0, if you look at the trivialization. So it's in the inverse of the determinant of cohomology. And, well, what can I say about the section? I can determine a zero set. Well, when is it zero at the point? Well, when is the determinant zero? This means that the map is not invertible at this point. And this means that either the kernel or the co-kernel are non-trivial. I mean, they both have the same dimension. And this is equivalent to the fact that the cohomology of E is non-trivial. This is equivalent to the zero set. so the cohomology. I mean, I could either take H0 or H1 because the Euler characteristic vanishes. They have the same dimension. But of course, now I took vector bundles with trivial determinants, so this usually won't hold. But what I can do, I can tensor with vector bundles. So in general, we can consider maybe the cohomology of a tensor product. Well, so F should be a vector bundle, and it should have the proper slope so that the Euler characteristic is zero. That means in this case it is slope g minus 1, so vector bundle. And the first observation is that this determinant of cohomology is the line bundle on the moduli space which classifies E. Doesn't really depend on F, it only depends on the rank of F. So determinant of alpha lambda, let's see, E tensor F depends only the rank of F. And this is very simple to see because if I have a modification, so if I have maybe I write k at a point x. So if I have a modification, well, let's say we have a subbundle and where they only differ at one point and I have this point at x, I can look at the long exact sequence of cohomology. And it gives me that determinant, so lambda c e tensor f is isomorphic to the tensor, what sort of the determinant of the fiber at x. But I assume that I take SLR bundles, where this is trivial. And so you see that these two are functorially isomorphic. I mean, the only thing, sort of the subtle point, is that I claimed that they are isomorphic, but I didn't claim that they are canonically isomorphic. But this is another point. So these determinant of cohomology bundles, so for each rank there is one, and it's the power of the one for E. And now I can try to find global sections which don't vanish at a given point. I just have to tensor E with a vector bundle F, such that this is trivial cohomology, and this can be done by some deformation argument. And this way you see that these theta functions, so these sections which I constructed here, generate some power of this. If the bundle is semi-stable, then they generate it there. Okay, I should have said this. And then you can also find projective embeddings of the semi-stable moduli space, stuff like this. So in this sense, I think sort of, I somehow understand the theory of theta functions for the group SLR. And so what I'm looking for is an analog of this theory for other groups. So the first thing, it's sort of classical known. For the orthogonal group, it has a square root. Yeah. So other groups. So if I have a group G, a semi-simple group, and if I have a representation, G goes to SLE in a vector space, of course, then it gives me a map on moduli stacks. So I have maybe I can just take the determinant of cohomology. Maybe I write this E, the corresponding vector bundles, so gives the line bundle. On MG. Ah, yes, I see, I forgot to say one thing. So the construction I gave you gives the generator of the
line bundles for the group SLR. Sorry, I forgot to say this. But so for general, I mean, groups G, I can pull back these line bundles and I get line bundles here, and I can sort of look where they lie in the classification. So where in pick MG, which I said you were the integers. And the rule is quite simple. Well, sort of there's a trace form, so there's a kappa, the trace form E. Maybe I should say sort of in characteristic zero, I mean in characteristic P, one would have to be a little bit careful about the number, but it can be done also in characteristic P. So I take the trace form, and that's an invariant bilinear form on the Lie algebra of E, and it's a multiple of a certain minimal form. So this is a multiple of the canonical bilinear form for B on the Lie algebra. And B is invariant, so B is G invariant. And it has the fact that B of the long root is equal to 2. So if theta is, well, that theta is the longest root, so maximal root. Well, so that if theta is long, then its dual is short, so B takes its small value there. And then on, if there are two lengths, then on the other one, it's either 4 or 6. And so there's a unique invariant form. And then it's a multiple of this form. And then sort of the index which I get is just this multiple. So then the index is multiple. For example, if you take the adjoint representation, so if E G was a adjoint representation, then you get as index, you get twice H check, where H check is a dual Cox eta number. Okay, maybe, I don't know whether I should mention, because everybody in this distinguished audience knows what it is. What? That's one possible definition. I mean, you also could, this is equal to, I hope it's, I get it fine, it's 1 plus rho of theta check, I mean, with the standard notation. And for example, for the SLN, so SLR is R, H check of E8 is 30, and so on. And this is always even, and this is no, well, this is no accident, because if I have an orthogonal, there's a fact that if I have an orthogonal representation, so if E is an orthogonal representation, then the determinant of cohomology admits the square root, the Pfaffian. So then it follows it. Has square root, which is called the Pfaffian. And the adjoint representation is always orthogonal because you have the, I mean, you have the form B or the Killing form, and so this means this is why, sort of there, I mean, the, in the classification should give you an even number. And also, while well, once you know this, then you sort of can get generators for the groups SON. So then you get, I mean, so if you take the standard representation for the group SON or spin N, well, I could take SON. Well, then this is obviously an orthogonal representation. by the definition of the orthogonal group. So it has an even, so you can take a square root, and in fact the square root gives you a generator. So it would give you index 2 or 1, so in the Pfaffian. It gives a generator. And also, well, yeah, also there's a square root of the theta function, and so, I mean, in this sense, I consider the problem solved for classical groups, and I must say, sort of, when I was young, I used to say that, I mean, the classical groups are all what counts, and the exceptional groups are for the old people, but now, since I'm getting older, I sort of have to deal with exceptional groups. So I mean, sort of the difference, the main difference between classical and exceptional groups is that for classical groups you have a small representation, like the standard representation for symplectic and orthogonal groups and so on, while for the exceptional group you only have the adjoint representation, and so the dimension of the adjoint representation is roughly the square of the dimension of the standard representation. And you are forced to not to think in terms of the standard representation, but in terms of roots and weights. And since I only learned this after I turned 20, I never really familiar with this language. But I try to do my best. So now I will talk about other groups. So what exceptional? What is a good procedure to start this way? I guess so, yeah. So. What?
I could have the lectern removed, but it's a terrible object. But more people can see if you go in there. I'm afraid you'll block the audience's view.
Oh, this cannot be moved. I just was thinking, what about the guys over there? But okay. Yeah. Yeah. So what about the exceptional groups? So for exceptional groups. Well, for example, for the group E8, which is sort of the most exceptional group, the best we can do is this sort of from representation. I mean, what we know so far is this index 30, which comes from the joint representation. And it turns out that sort of other representations give only multiples of this. So from this geometric construction, you can only get this index. And you look for something else. So the question is whether there are sort of canonical sections like the theta function for the group E8, let's say. And then, I thought about this, and I couldn't think of a geometric thing, and so I started to do maybe a physics thing or maybe a stupid thing. I sort of started to calculate dimensions. Namely, what one can do, so one takes the L, maybe LC. Well, this is a line bundle of you just call it central charge C, this index. And so I just sort of take the minimal, the generator, and look at the dimension of the space of global sections. And if it is 1 or so, then I think there's a canonical element in there. So. And then I started to remember that I once did this calculation, and it's called the Velinde formula. So it's computed by the and it works the following way. Well, first of all, one knows that this is independent of the curve because there's a so-called projective connection. And also one does a more general thing, so one can compute the one sort of adds those which I call trivial line bundles, so I take a tensor product maybe of EI of xi. This means I choose finitely many points in the curve, and I choose irreducible representations of G and take the associated vector bundles and the vector bundles on the stack, and I try to compute these. So ei associated maybe I first do this for general C. Well, and then sort of this one observation one makes that for most of these representations it's zero, namely it's only non-zero if the ei are integrable. So this is zero unless all ei are integrable. And this means that if lambda is a maximum weight, then sort of lambda on the co-weight is less equal to this number C. And this is sort of easy to see because otherwise you sort of can embed a P1 into your moduli stack such that the line bundle has negative, something has negative degree there, and so all global sections will vanish. Okay, that's the first observation. Then well, then the second thing is one does this by degenerating the curve. So degenerate the curve. C into C P1 with G pairs of points. So XI identified. We get something like a, I don't know, I'm bad in drawing, so like a nodal curve. Let's say for genus 2, you identify two points on the pairs of points on the P1. And then, well, how? Okay, I do some cheating now, but that's okay because I don't have infinite amount of, I don't want to give out the fine print. So if you think about G bundles on such a singular curve, they can be obtained by G bundles on the normalization by identifying the fibers at those two points. So G bundles on, yeah, and if I identify two, the fibers at two points, then this is given by an element of G. So then the G bundles on C, they form a G to the R, G to the little g torsor over the G bundles on the normalization, which is now the P1. I mean, I sort of, I have a bundle on the P1 and identify the fibers in those points. And, well, but if I look at the regular, so I want to have vector bundles on these, so I sort of have to look at functions on G to the G. But I know that the functions on G, I mean, let's say, I should say characteristic zero, this argument. The function on G, I know how to decompose into irreducibles. So I know that O of G is the sum of the maybe all irreducibles E tensor dual. And this way I get that the so gamma of mg, L, maybe I write only lc, but I also could put in additional factors, is a direct sum so of gamma, maybe mg tilde on the normalization of lc tensor, maybe e of xi. So this means I, for each pair of points, I choose an irreducible representation, and I put the representation at one point and it's dual at the other point, and then I take the tensor product and I do this for all pairs and sum over all of these, and this gives me the direct sum. And of course it's finite because there are only finite dimensional integrable representation, and I already told you if I have a non-integrable representation then this is zero, so I get this decomposition. Okay, and then one can evaluate this, but now maybe the only original observation which I made here is that if C is equal to 1, so then the condition on integrability means that lambda of theta hat, so integrability, is equal to 1. And if there is only one root length, this means that the representation is minuscule. So if G only one root length, this means that E is minuscule. And then one knows that there are not too many minuscule representations, namely the order is the order of the center, and if G is equal to E8, so if G is equal to E8, then E must be trivial. So this means in this whole computation we have a certain simplifications because all the E's must be trivial, so that I can drop them out, and I get the same thing for the curve as for its normalization. And for the normalization one easily gets 1, so this means the dimension is 1. So the dimension L1 is 1. Okay, so there exists a canonical divisor on the moduli stack of E8 bundles. And then the question which I couldn't solve is, what is it like? So what is it, CO? Oh, I should say one thing, I said characteristic zero, but sort of in positive characteristic U, using the Hitchin vibration, you can get an upper bound for the space of section, which is also 1. And then by semi-continuity, I mean it's at least 1, so you get the same thing in all characteristics. But, yeah, okay, so, but then, I mean, well, so then, well, to illustrate this problem, there sort of, I do this, I mean, you can do the following. Well, I give you a problem which is not quite this one, but which is similar. If you have a C, the curve, then you can look at the Jacobian of C. And it's known that it has a principal polarization. And if you have a principal polarization, you get sort of, you can get theta divisors, but you don't get a canonical theta divisor because they are only unique up to translation. And sort of, you can look at symmetric theta divisors. They are not unique, but there is a finite number, so it has 2 to the 2g, so symmetric theta divisors. And they somehow correspond to the square roots of the canonical bundle. But if you do jc to the 8, then it has a polarization which is a tensor product of the canonical polarization in the E8 quadratic form. And because the E8 quadratic form is even, there's a canonical even line bundle in ample line bundle in the polarization class. So it has a canonical even line bundle. And this means there's a canonical even theta divisor on this product. And so the question is, so I mean there are certain 8 tuples of line bundles of degree 0 on the curve which are different from other 8 tuples. And so the question is, I don't know how to give a geometric characterization of those. So as canonical even theta. Okay, so this is, I already couldn't do this in Paris. So now I will talk sort of what I could do. Namely, I tried to compute examples of geometric divisors. So, oh, now I made a, no. Oh, no. I guess I have to start erasing. Okay. Oh, this is still, oh, yes, so, yeah, okay. Oh, there are four. Oh, there are four, wow, okay. Let's do things in the bottom. Ooh. Now I see why you have this exercise room in the...
Okay, but I shouldn't climb in here.
So examples of divisors. Well, sort of all the examples I know come from nilpotent endomorphisms. So nilpotent. Well, so I have to talk a little bit about the Hitchin vibration. Namely, on the moduli space, maybe I call this H. There's a fiber space where H sort of classifies, so G bundles. It's P plus a section of, gamma C, maybe GP. So I mean the twist of the Lie algebra and tensored with the canonical divisor. And well, and the MG, usually it has dimension, is sort of the dimension of G times G minus 1. And this one has twice the dimension. Simply because you have this extra data. And it's known that this is a symplectic manifold because you have, I mean, sort of this is canonically the dual of the H1 of GP, so this is symplectic. And it has also has a map to the characteristic variety. Ah, so I made a mistake here. Okay, so. Namely, if you have an invariant polynomial on, so if f is in, so maybe g dual, g invariant, an invariant polynomial, I can look sort of degree e, so degree e, then f of theta, comma c, theta e. So it gives me a multi. Well, a sort of differential form of higher order. And it's known that the invariant functions are a polynomial algebra with the number of generators, the rank of the Lie algebra. And so I can take these and then they give me, they live in some linear space. So I get a map from the Hitchin moduli space to a linear space, which is a direct sum of copies of these with some exponents. And it's known that the fibers are Lagrangian, so the fibers, or maybe fibers are isotropic. And so the dimension is at most half the dimension of the H. But also, I mean, you can compute this dimension and it turns out to be also have the dimension of the moduli space, so it's g minus dimension g times g minus 1. And so this means the fibers are complete, I mean, they are given by locally so many equations, but because they are isotropic, their dimension is the right number, so they are complete intersections, and I mean, so the map is flat, and so on and so forth. And so one can map the fibers to mg, and then in general, I mean, the fibers have the same dimension as mg, so in general, this will be a finite covering. But there's one exception, namely if all the values are zero. So if all, all f of theta equals zero, which means that theta is nilpotent. Well, namely, then there's a GM action on these, namely, if theta is nilpotent, then also 2 theta is nilpotent. So there's a GM action. So there's a GM action. Fiber. And the map factors over, the map to mg factors over this GM action, because if I multiply theta by a scalar, then the torsor doesn't change. And so this means the fibers are at least one-dimensional, so the image lies in a proper divisor. So then the image has dimension. Less equal g minus 1. So you can expect to get a divisor. And so you can try to compute its, it gives a line bundle, and so you can compute its place on the classification, which is an integer. But then, of course, it turns out that these, this space of nilpotence is very complicated. In G itself, there are sort of only finitely many conjugacy classes, but if you have a family, then the conjugacy class may jump, and also the thing may become zero. And in fact, I sort of do the simply case. I only take things which lie in the closed conjugacy classes, which is the one given by the roots. So closed conjugacy class. Of nilpotence. This is sort of, we get this by, we get the orbit of one, of any long root, of any long co-root. Maybe I write x theta. So I take an element in the root space for the long root, and these elements I call root vectors, and then I take the conjugates of these. And because the long root is normalized by a parabolic, this gives me a closed orbit in the projective thing. So this is called root vectors. Usually I call it root vectors. I should say long root vectors, but usually I think about E8 as the most interesting case, and there's no difference between those. So I look at sections which are long root vectors, which are root vectors or zero everywhere, and I try to compute their number. Of course, the solution of using this one only is temporary. How to compute central charges. I do the following. So I have a divisor in the moduli space, and so I have to intersect it with a suitable curve and count the intersection number. And so I get a map from P1 to the moduli space as follows. I choose one bundle, maybe I do it for SLR. So you have a bundle E, and you choose a point X in C. So for SLR, you have a trivial bundle. And then sort of you choose a modification to choose bundles E minus contained in E plus. So these are modifications at the point x of length 1. So the quotients e plus e and e modulo e minus And also the whole quotient sort of should be annihilated by a local generator at x, so meaning that they're not maybe theta, I mean kx vector space. And then as families, I take all other bundles which are in here, so P1 classifies. And then the E prime will have the right determinant, so I get a family. And so I have to look at how many of those E prime have a nilpotent root vector endomorphism. Okay, but now I'm back to the old problem. Since this board is off limits. So if you have such a root vector, then, I mean, sort of you have to classify this, and this lies also in the homomorphism. Because, I mean, it fixes this in between, and so it maps this one into that one. And, in fact, one can show, I mean, one can talk about root vectors here, meaning elements which sort of already in the generic fiber are a root vector. And one can check if one has a root vector in here, then there's a unique E prime, well, under some condition, so that it lies in here, there. So this means we have to look at the root vectors in this product. So look at root vectors. Yeah. And then, well, this is sort of contained in and E tensor omega C with double pole in X. And also, well, this modification gives you sort of a canonical root vector in the fiber at X of this one. And then one checks that one just gets the root vectors which lifts this canonical one. So have a, I mean, so lifts off a canonical root vector at X. I mean, sort of, there are some conditions on E which has to be sufficiently generic, but then this is true. And so you have this problem, sort of, you have this, you have a root vector in the fiber at x of this, and you try to lift it to global sections, and you have to count the number of ways you can do this. And so, well, I mean, of course, then you have to know how to do such things, which I didn't. So I first thought about, computation with Chern classes and so, but I didn't get anywhere. And so the thing which I could do is, again, well, like here, like degenerating the curve. So degenerate the curve. So first I can degenerate to a chain of elliptic curve. So chain of and let's see, I have my point x here. And then sort of I have a root vector at this point, I want to extend it. So this gives me a section on the first elliptic curve. Then this gives me the value at the beginning of the next curve. So I have the same problem. I again have to extend the root vector and so on. And so this means the number which I get is the power of the number which I get for elliptic curve. So number for curve. genus G is sort of number genus 1 to the G. I mean, you have sort of have to do the things. I mean, you have to check how they lift to the smooth curve and so on. This can be done. So this means we are down to elliptic curves. Well, then for genus 1, so for the classical group, for the SLR, sort of I could do this computation with Chern classes. I mean, for SLR, I get the number 2R. And of course, for attentive, I mean, for other groups, then, I mean, people who have followed the talk, of course, they know what this means. So Pierre knows, so I don't have to explain. I mean, so this can be done by computation with Chern classes. I mean, you sort of get a vector bundle of certain rank, and you have a generic section, you count the number with zero, which is the highest Chern class. But for the exceptional group, so for E8 or so, I had to do a further degeneration. I degenerate the elliptic curves into a P1 with two points identified. So E goes to a P1. And then sort of I get the problem on P1 and on the Lie algebra. And so, which is interesting, counting problem, but sort of at the end, so I got that the number is 60, of course, so it's always 2H. So I get, I mean, you sort of have to look at certain quadratic maps into the nilpotent cone, which have certain conditions, and to count the number of solutions. Yeah, but maybe this is a little bit too technical. So I got this number 60, and so, so for this one, so the number is always this 2H hat to the G. Which unfortunately, well, I mean, it's, I mean, for the elliptic, for the E8, I already could get from the adjoint representation, I got a 60, and now I only get a 60 to the G. So it's sort of, I mean, yeah. So this is what I wanted to report. And I mean, sort of my secret goal, of course, over the summer was to get some number for E8. In this sense, I can say, in this country, one says mission accomplished. But of course, the real problem would be to get something of central charge 1. But I know even in this country, you declare things accomplished, even if it's not quite finished. So maybe I can, this is it. I mean, this is the easiest. I mean, you can look at nilpotent sections. If you have a theta nilpotent, and then sort of, I mean, at the generic point, it lies in some conjugacy class. And then at special points, the conjugacy class may jump. For example, you might have a sort of a Jordan decomposition of an endomorphism. And usually, I mean, sort of the Rth power is only zero, but at some points, it has nilpotent of lower order. And so this makes it very complicated to calculate these numbers. And sort of for the closed orbit, I mean, the advantage is that they're sort of, I mean, it cannot jump to a lower orbit. It can only become zero, which you can usually exclude. So this makes it easier to compute. I mean, I'm thinking about other cases, but it's, one point, it's sort of, from general reasons, I told you that the nilpotent endomorphism lie in a proper divisor. But it's very difficult to construct bundles which don't have any. So also, you know that there are many of them. Obviously, if you write down a concrete bundle, like the trivial bundle or so, it tends to have plenty of such endomorphisms. Yes? Oh, yes, I mean, they're sort of, they come, well, sort of I get, I mean, in general, I, well, sort of the number which I computed here, which was E8 was 1, I mean, I get sort of the order of the center to the G. So I get the order, I think this is to the G. This is sort of explainable because I have an action of H1 of C with values in the center on the sections. And this has a canonical central extension. I mean, there's a bilinear form. So I have a GM extension. And this, and one can know that this GM extension operates with a canonical character on the center. So this means that well, each irreducible representation is a multiple of a fixed one which has this dimension. This means that canonical sections form an irreducible representation. And when for the SLR, sort of, you just get then, I mean, you tensor your line, yeah. I mean, you get sort of get an, it's related to the Picard group, to the Jacobian things of length n. Oh, I should say also, I mean, I said E8, you could also do, if you don't like E8, you could also talk about the orthogonal groups for the spin n, or spin 2n, if n is divisible by 2, so spin 4n at the end. You know that the fundamental group is Z2 cross Z2. And so there are interesting subgroups in here, which are sort of, I mean, this coming from the Z2, which are, they don't depend on the curve. And for one of them, the invariants are given by the Pfaffian. But there are two other sort of subgroups which would correspond to the spin representation. So there should be theta functions which somehow correspond, theta devices which somehow correspond to the spin representation, which I also don't know how to construct.
Further questions? The question?
Yeah. Suppose you move your curve.
Yes?
That you don't get kind of your sections will form a bundle with
yes.
projective connection. And well, if you take this central charge sufficiently high, well, then you know the space, presumably you know the space of sections. Well, but.
Well, I wouldn't.
One dimensional subspace inside
yeah.
of the thing.
No, I don't know. I have no.
Why don't you repeat the question?
I mean, so the idea was sort of to look from L1 to LC. So if you have a section here, you take a T's power, I understand, and you get a section here. So the first claim that you understand all local sections here, which I sort of have some difficulties with. And the next one, sort of to recover this one from here. But I mean, sort of, I mean, my test case is sort of this E8 for, let's say, for an elliptic curve. And I mean, I don't understand anything about it. So even if I take powers of it, yeah.
Any further questions?
Yes?
What can be done for vector 1 that is a fixed determinant?
Oh, these are sort of twisted forms of the ones with a. And I think anything essentially goes for twisted form. I mean, the Verlinde formula, the thing is sort of have to change this connection between E and its duals. Sort of you have to put in an automorphism. And then sort of the thing works. But I mean, yeah. But for the E8, I think there's no difference. Yeah.